What the heck is that, and what on earth have you done with Jafro? This is a departure from the norm for me. I bought this 99 Ford F-150 XL model short bed standard cab pickup back in 2005 and I paid cash for it outright. It's been extremely inexpensive to maintain. Aside from its fuel bill and scheduled maintenance, it's only been tires and wiper blades. I had one major breakdown that was a $50 fix and I made a video about that back when it happened. But anyway, here we are many years later and it's starting to show its age a bit. I've got some suspension problems that will prevent it from passing my state inspection, which is due. I need to do the scheduled maintenance, and I wanted to give it a checkup and inspect the health of the service work I performed many moons ago. Turn your head and cough kind of thing. If anything isn't up to snuff, I'm going to take this opportunity to fix it. This XL trim model pickup is less than luxurious and it's extremely intentional. The instrumentation is minimal, if not lacking, but it's never really presented a problem for me. I bought this thing to be rugged and to haul not to read my emails, sort MP3s, and text message people with. For my intended purposes, it's exceeded my expectations, has continually been the most reliable thing in my driveway. I'm glad the odometer decided to join us. The odometer is narcoleptic and one of its triggers is bumpy roads. Still counts correctly though. There's also not much on this truck to brake. This is the most utilitarian vehicle I've ever owned. Headlights that pull out to turn on the fog lights, but I'm not equipped with the fog lights. Dimmer, column shifter with the overdrive button cover broken off, combination intermittent wipers, window washer, signal light, high beam switch, AM/FM 4-button radio, ridiculously cold AC that I had rebuilt and the compressor replaced back in 2012, and two, count them, two 12-volt outlets. There's two cup holders in the dash and one more if you flip the center seat armrest down, and a keyed switch to disable the passenger side airbag. There's a thing on this truck that used to come with every car, but new cars don't have them anymore. It's called an ashtray. There was once a time when the luxury of a car was determined by how many ashtrays it contained. There's a glove box that can't hold a dachshund, or perhaps it'll hold a couple of Yorkies or a ferret, but it's got the owner's manual, service schedule, and the original purchaser's registration. It's pretty bare bones. There's a pocket that you can put your cell phone in, forget about it, and lose track of it for days on end. Right there, that's where you'll find your phone. There's the hood latch and the emergency brake release. Then you got this panel that has, I immediately regret this decision. There's nothing inside there, nothing I need anyway. Now I've got to put this dang panel back on. Mental note. Pulling that panel off is fruitless. Leave it there. This thing was stripped down. They couldn't afford to put anything behind this panel. No power options, manual everything in the doors, but the speakers sound pretty good. I've never changed anything or customized it. There's nothing to steal. See the lovely rubber flooring? It's a truck that you can sponge clean. I'd say power wash, but the seats are cloth, so. Anyway, it has a split bench seat that reclines and offers lumbar support. The only thing wrong with the interior is the wear on the driver's seat. Oh, and the headliner, but I'm just about to fix that. I've experienced 10 years of extreme utility every time I've been behind the wheel of this thing. Literally zero luxury aside from its reliability and durability. But now it's getting old, running rough, and I'm going to give it a complete checkup with some simple tests. Recently I noticed the coolant's a little bit low. Nothing's leaking beneath the engine bay, except for water from the ice-cold AC condenser. However, if the coolant is low and no leaks can be found, there's a possibility that coolant might be getting burnt in the combustion chamber and leaving out the exhaust pipe. There are a series of tests you can perform that will tell you everything you want to know about the health of your engine. The fastest way is to spend between 20 and 50 bucks for one of these block tester kits that can detect the presence of combustion chamber gases in your coolant system. It's a really simple kit. It consists of some testing fluid, a test cylinder, an aspirator bulb, and a set of instructions that you should read and follow. You can pause that if you want to read more. This is the important side. The other side is about ways to use up more test fluid so that you can buy more faster, and how you should clean out the tool when you're finished. There's already dozens of great videos about this device on YouTube, and I don't know why we need another one. I'm just using this tool as part of my diagnosis. It's super easy to use this thing, and it only takes a few minutes to get your results. For those of you who haven't seen this test before, you start by firing up your engine and letting it run until it's warm, or until the thermostat opens. You fill the tool with test fluid up to the fill line, install the aspirator bulb with the metal valve facing up, wedge it into the radiator fill hole, or in my case, the coolant reservoir, and then squeeze it to suck air up from the coolant system up through the fluid. If there are compression or combustion gases containing hydrocarbons, which should never be present in the coolant system, then the blue testing fluid begins turning a greenish or yellowish color. I've actually done this several times over the past 10 minutes as the engine warmed up, and I got nothing. I'm really happy to find this test fluid isn't changing color at all. Things get expensive and time-consuming if this test fails, but we're not out of the woods just yet. It doesn't test for everything. It doesn't test for coolant leaks, and it doesn't tell you anything about your compression limits. It just tests for one particular side effect from three specific and expensive types of coolant leaks. It tests for blown head gaskets, cracked heads, or a cracked block. I have none of these. I passed it in flying colors. It's important that you discard the test fluid no matter what the test results were because it's contaminated. Do not pour used blue fluid back into the bottle of fresh testing fluid just because it didn't change color. It's single use and that's how it goes. When you're done with your testing, thoroughly flush out the tester with clean water. Go watch other people's videos for technical details about this kind of test. I threw one in the description that I've always liked because the dude's got a really nice WS6. So why is the coolant low? Let's pressure test the entire coolant system and find out. Depending on the car, you're supposed to have between 12.5 and 16 psi of coolant pressure, and that keeps it from boiling. This kit consists of a pump with a pressure gauge, a collection of popular fittings for radiator caps and coolant overflow tanks, and this is the one that fits most Ford and GM stuff that have coolant tanks. Make sure that the mating surfaces are free of dirt and debris, and honk it all down tight. When you're ready to start testing, pop the pressure release valve down to seal it all up and start pumping. The coolant system needs to be topped off at its full line during this test, and it works best if it's fully warmed up so that the thermostat is open. As long as the needle stays settled at a point slightly above your coolant system's rated pressure, then it's not leaking. It only takes a few drops of coolant to make this thing lose a whole pound of pressure, so if you have any leak at all, you'll know in less than a minute. This scene, however, is a 40-minute long segment accelerated to only 17 seconds. It ain't moving, so the intake manifold gaskets are fine. No coolant leaks from anywhere else? I've got a healthy, perfectly sealed coolant system, so that means the coolant was just low. I just wanted to do these tests first to rule out the difficult and expensive problems that might lead to a rough-running engine. And since I can't afford nice tools like this coolant system pressure tester on a YouTube budget, I'm going to quickly clean it and return it to its rightful owner. Here I am over at Chad's garage doing a burnout, because what are friends for, right? I mentioned before that it was running rough, but it's a little more than that. It's a loss of power and an occasional backfire. Drop that hammer, Jafro. Just doesn't make any power. You can hear the engine straining to fart, you can see the condensation, and the whole garage smells like rotten eggs. I'm pretty sure that back when my lower intake manifold gaskets failed, it caused my catalytic converters to clog, and it also caused the big rusted out hole in my muffler, so I ordered a whole new exhaust just to be sure. Chad didn't have any more time for my foolishness and threw me out. Here we have everything necessary to wash, clean, and protect all of this truck's surfaces. Also, everything necessary to replace the 215,000-mile-old hardware for the rear drum brakes and hydraulics, along with an oil change and a tune-up. Oil filter, and the filters for the fuel system, air intake, and a useless cabin filter that I don't need because my truck doesn't have it. I also have some new OE-recommended platinum plugs and plug wires, and all of the ball joints for the front end. Let's start with the drum brakes. I have a little vibration from the rear, and even though I just had the brakes serviced a year ago, I didn't replace anything other than the pads, drums, two axle bearings, and axle seals. When I did that job, the axles were still good. I felt one going bad and changed both of them just in time. But since the vibration's now returned, I bought a complete spring and tensioner kit for both sides, as well as new wheel cylinders. The wheel cylinders are overkill because neither one's leaking, but it was only $80 for all of this stuff, and it eliminates every bit of what could be contributing to that problem. My cousin trusted me well enough to use his brake lathe. It brought back good memories. Sorry, no footage of that happening, but this is what it looked like afterwards. It's way too nice of a tool for me to be using again, and because I left it so filthy, I'll probably never be invited back. So with the true, perfect braking surface now cut into the drums, it's time for demolition and reconstruction. Brake drums can be one of those frustrating automotive systems because everything in it is spring-loaded. It works to your advantage when you're taking them apart, but you have to put it all back together in the right order. As long as you know what that order is, you're fine. But if you're a rookie, just leave one assembled while you complete the other side, so you have a reference of what you're shooting for. If your brake manufacturer was nice enough to include new horseshoe clips with your brake pads, good on you. Otherwise, be careful taking the old clips off so that you can reuse them. You're not supposed to, but brake pads don't always have them in the box, and lots of people do it. If you're tackling a brake job yourself at home, use liquid solvents to clean up all of your parts. Don't use compressed air. If you're replacing wheel cylinders, take the brake line loose before you remove the bolts. Compare the replacement part to the old one to make sure you have the right part for the correct side, because some of these are directional. It can rust itself in place, so pry it out with a pry bar or a flathead screwdriver if you have to. Install the line before you install the bolts, because it's easier to line everything up, then snug the bolts and tighten the line. There's a short shoe and a long shoe. The long shoe goes up the rear. Your brake pads should come with a new horseshoe clip. Use two hands to pop the retainer springs in place. Also, don't forget to swap over your push rods from the old wheel cylinder, because it's a terrible thing to discover later after you've got it all assembled. Make sure that that's done before the second shoe goes in. With the retainer springs installed, these things stay pretty well in place while we install all the rest of the parts that go in here. It's parking brake lever, horseshoe clip, both brake pad retainer springs, guide, washer, adjuster cable. Medium length return spring goes on the rear shoe, and it snaps through the center of the adjuster cable pivot guide, holding it in place. Next, install the center strut and the spring assemblies between the two brake shoes. The short return spring secures the front shoe and keeps all that together while we get the tensioner assembly put together. The long spring that was in the pile goes across the bottom of both shoes with the coiled end facing the front of the vehicle. Now install the adjuster level return spring, the adjuster lever, and hook up the adjuster cable to the lever. We're almost done. All that's left is the tensioner and the drum itself. I'm using a new tensioner, so I'm greasing it up with high temperature anti-seize. Be sure to lube both the main shaft and the cap, tighten it all the way down, stretch the brake pads apart, and then wrangle this thing in there. You can put up a fight sometimes. I should have remembered to lubricate the flat spots behind the brake shoes prior to assembly, but I didn't. So I'm sneaking some lube in there with a flathead. Next, we test fit the drum and make sure there's a tiny bit of brake drag. If not, I'd have to adjust the tensioner, but this fits pretty close to perfect. Here's a super HD extreme close-up of my passenger side brake drum with everything in the right places. Note how the medium spring serves as an axis for the tensioner cable guide. Notice the tensioner cable spring is floating in front of the long spring, and how the tensioner itself contacts the tensioner lock. If you get the cable behind the long spring, it locks the tensioner in place. There are some people who can put a puzzle together without looking at the box. I've done it both ways, but I prefer looking at the box. There's your box. Very important that everything fits this way, or else your tensioner will fail and you'll gradually lose proper function of the whole brake assembly. So that's one down, one to go. This side of the truck was really cramped, and really this is more of the same, so I'm going to accelerate this to ludicrous speed here. For details about every step, how and why, I've put a link in the description for someone else's brake video that outlines the entire process in glorious detail. I didn't even tell them I was going to do it, how rude of me. But really, there's so many great videos about the most popular trucks sold in America that I'm not trying to muddy the waters here. I'd rather point you to the hard work in video production that's already been done before me. If you need the half hour brake job rather than my 5 minute cliff notes, please visit the description. That's it for the rear brake job. I have to bleed them before it leaves the garage because the wheel cylinders were removed and replaced, so the brake system is going to be full of air. But before I bleed anything, I like to top off the reservoir first. I always start with the wheel furthest from the master cylinder and then work backwards. And you'll find the bleeder screw behind a rubber cap on the wheel cylinder. A proper vacuum bleeder works best because it isn't messy, but this tool works mostly the same. It's just that this tool happens to be messy. It's what I do if I don't have someone's help mashing the pedal. And one of these days I'll get myself a proper vacuum bleeder because they have a million and one uses. It's time to put the wheels back on, drop it on the ground, torque the lugs, and then turn this thing around for round two. It's important whenever your wheel captures a brake drum or a brake rotor that you torque your lugs evenly, because failure to do so can lead to warping of the brake drums and rotors with repeated heat cycling that occurs from normal use of the brakes. I always use a torque wrench and torque my lugs to an even 100 foot-pounds. Now what? F-150 ball joints, that's what. Every few years my F-150 chews through a set of ball joints. This is a proper ball joint press kit. This kit contains the C-clamp, anvils, and ball joint adapters. With the help of an impact gun, there's not a ball joint out there that stands a chance against this thing. But what fun is there in using the right tool for the job? We're just going to close this thing back up and use some scrap metal and a piece of 2 3/8-inch stainless steel pipe that I've got laying around. On the vast majority of ball joint jobs, there's no need to use that enormous kit unless one gives you trouble. You've seen me tackle my Mitsubishi, Dodge, and Hyundai ball joints dozens of times before as I pull engines and transmissions, and so what I'm doing might look really familiar to you. But on my rear-wheel drive truck, I don't have any axles to deal with. It makes it a whole lot easier for me, really. After you get the wheel and the brakes out of the way, separate the steering link by removing the cotter pin and castle nut that hold the tie rod in place, and then beat the knuckle side of the joint with a hammer. Next, remove the cotter pin and the castle nut, apply pressure to the lower control arm with a floor jack to help you separate the joint. Again, you want to hit the knuckle side of the joint to separate the tapered ball joint stud. For crying out loud, I lost a scene of separating the upper joint and the knuckle because of a dead battery, sorry guys. Next, I'm removing the snap ring. Now I'm using a socket to beat the old ball joint out of the lower control arm. The angle iron braces the lower control arm against the earth so that the force of the hammer is absorbed by only the ball joint and not your bushings. You take your new ball joint, you insert it into the 2 3/8-inch outer diameter Schedule 80 pipe, brace the new ball joint against the earth, and use the weight of the truck and the suspension to beat the lower control arm back down over the new ball joint. Install your snap ring, install your grease fittings, and then make sure that they point in a direction where you can reach them in the future. Reposition your jack stands and move on with your day. Leave the ball joint press in its case. The upper ball joint of my F-150 includes an A-arm and upper bushings. The ball joint just happens to come with it. These are the original 215,000-mile-old upper control arms, and they're toast. The boot's ripped, the grease is gone, the joint's sloppy, and the replacement is simple. After the joint is separated, there's just 2 bolts, 2 nuts, and 2 washers holding it in. I always mark the upper control arm bolts whether or not they're eccentric, and line them all up back the same way again when I'm done. It's just a thing, it's a good practice, but I don't have to do that here because these aren't eccentric bolts. Once they're removed, the old arm comes out and the new one goes right in. That's it. Put the bolts back in place, but don't honk them all the way down yet. Reinstall the front knuckle and reassemble the lower joint first. It just makes things easier. Next, install the boot so that the gap on the boot faces the knuckle, and install the grease fitting. The next order of business is reinstalling the knuckle. I use my floor jack to support the knuckle and to easily raise it up into both joints because I'm lazy. I don't like working hard. You can do this however you want. I'm not getting any younger. Next comes the castle nuts for both joints and then the cotter pins. After those are secured, reattach the tie rod, castle nut, and install a new cotter pin. Only after all of your suspension parts are reassembled should you line up your marks on the upper A-arm bolts and securely tighten them. Before you put wheels back on the vehicle or put it back down on the pavement, fill the ball joint and boot with grease through the grease fitting until the grease leaks out of the boot. If you don't, the joint will fail very quickly after you put it back into service. Some things are just easier to do with the wheel not in your way, so... Speaking of which, the truck is already backed in and supported with jack stands, and I need to do an oil change. How convenient. You saw it here first, people. A bug crawled out of my butt. I feel much better already. I'm so relieved. But anyway, drain the oil, change the filter, 6 quarts go back in, and then I'll see you again in 3,000 miles or 6 months later, whichever one comes first. It's pretty simple. Because I'm done underneath and on this side of the truck, I'm going to put the wheel back on, put this thing on the ground, and top it off. There, 6 quarts. Now to torque the lug nuts. And now to do the other side. Lug cap. Lug nuts. You know the drill. There's a smooth spot worn on the inside of the tire because I took a 1998 CRV to the wheel. And it's what caused these ball joints to fail in the first place. I have to admit, it's the only car that ever hit my truck and caused damage. And it's the only one to ever drive away afterwards. I'm impressed. But that wear pattern indicates the wheel is out of alignment, and that's the worst accident damage this truck has ever experienced. But moving on, it's brake time. Hang them out of the way with whatever you've got. Bungee cord, rope, or in my case, it's baling wire. Pull the cotter pin, remove the castle nut, and separate the steering linkage. Pull the other cotter pin and castle nut for the lower ball joint. Brace the lower control arm and beat the knuckle loose from the ball joint. If you're replacing the ball joint, it's giving you trouble. You can lift from the stud, but don't do that if you plan to reuse it because you'll damage the threads. After you feel it pop, you just have to reposition the jack to finish separating the joint. You're out of the shot, Jafro. Daggone it. When you separate the upper joint, leave the castle nut on the stud with two or three threads so you don't drop the whole knuckle assembly on you or on the floor when it comes loose. The nut stops it from falling. Nice work on the camera there, Jafro. This is the same thing you saw on the other side. Pull the snap ring. Beat the ball joint out with a hammer. It's not complicated. I've never owned a rust bucket that was bad enough to ever need a ball joint press. The only thing you need to watch out for if you replace your ball joints this way is to never risk damaging a good ball joint's boot or its threads. Not unless you feel like replacing it. If you ever see a ball joint doing this, this is bad. If you feel slop in it, that's bad. If you can hear one go clickety-clack like mine, that's really, really bad. If you find your rubber boots cut or torn, it's just a matter of time before it fails because moisture and dirt get in there contaminating the joint, causing it to wear down and get sloppy. Sealed factory ball joints like this one don't have grease fittings that allow you to refill the grease. I love this pipe. This was actually a TIG welding sample that Chad brought me before he welded my intercooler together. And it just turns out to be the best Ford F-150 ball joint tool ever made. There's stuff out there that's much fancier than this, that takes 10 times as long to rig up and use, but I have other stuff to do, like put this thing back together and move on to the next thing. If your tires look like mine, or you have to fight the wheel in order to stay in your lane when you hit a bump going around a turn, that's not safe. That's a pretty good sign that your ball joints are shot. Your wheel needs to be held on with a minimum of 3 points in order for you to be able to steer. If a ball joint or a tie rod lets go, you lose your steering only at the very least. We're not even going to talk about the worst. Just don't let your ball joints ever get this bad. Don't wait for them to fail. This job can be expensive on some cars, but it's a whole lot more if you have to pay someone else to do it. If you own a car, this is something worth learning how to do. It's not hard and it saves you money. Most cars just take a hammer, a big floor jack, some scrap wood or steel, and a pipe, some snap ring pliers, and someone else's grease gun that you borrowed. You should already own your own jack stands, wrenches, and sockets if you work on cars. The tools don't have to be complicated, as I've clearly demonstrated here. Never, and I mean never, put these new ball joints back on the street without first filling them up with grease. If your ball joints came with grease fittings, fill them immediately until the grease squishes out of the boot, or else they'll bind up and fail. And giving them an extra squirt of grease at each oil change will ensure that they last you a good long time. Now you've reached that stage where you're asking yourself what any of this has to do with a tune-up to fix a random misfire issue. Well, I knew I had some brake and steering issues to work out, and my inspection was due. With the Hyundai giving me a fit and going back under the knife, I had to keep the truck in service until another vehicle was running, because I wanted to have the time I needed to fix every last issue this truck has, and to do it properly. But now I'm going to do the 60,000 mile tune-up. It's 58,000 miles since I did the last one. A tune-up, at its most basic description, is new plugs, wires, filters, PCV valve, and an oil change. Because it's a Ford, I use Motorcraft parts. I don't know how I ended up with Autolite wires, but I've used them before and I've had good results. I also have a compression gauge, but it's been giving me problems, so I'm trying to get my hands on another one for a compression test. There's a label in the engine bay of most cars and trucks that has engine specs, emissions info, and your spark plug gap on it. You see right there it says 52 thousandths to 56 thousandths of an inch. Saves you all the time digging through your glove box or searching the internet. The plugs I'm using are OE recommended platinum plugs for my Ford F-150 4.2 liter V6. Lots of people pull plugs out of the box and slap them in the car claiming, "They're pre-gapped!" Even if they're right, they're stupid for not checking them. You are the last step in quality control. The gap tool's a dollar, buy five and stash them everywhere like Easter eggs. Throw one in your glove box, truck box, tool box, tackle box, and anywhere else you might encounter a combustion engine. Setting your gap is easy. The gap gets wider as you go clockwise around the graduated scale. Where the plug stops is your measurement. So you squish the gap tool around to where the correct gap would be, and it spreads the electrode out to where you need it. Always double check your measurement a second time and fine tune if necessary. You want them all to be the same. There you go, 52 thousandths. I'm happy with that. Now just do it five more times. Call it foreshadowing, but right now is a good time to check your ceramic insulators too. I like to use hose clamp pliers low down on the boot to pull the plug wires free. You can never be too careful with plug wires. You never know when you're going to end up with the wrong set or a defective replacement, so you should always pull from the boot, not the wires, to avoid damaging them. I'm going to give each of mine an inspection on the way out just to see how things are going in the combustion chambers. This plug is burnt slam up. I got all my money's worth out of that one. The insulator's brown from burning cheap gas, but nothing's broken or missing. It's just a little, wow, 63 thousandths, that one's done. Looks like number one's running a little bit hot, just a little. Put the new plug back and take its respective plug wire off. You only need to be careful to save the little plastic wire management stuff because your new plugs won't come with anything that fits as nicely. Doing the plug wires one at a time prevents you from having to figure out your firing order later after you've plugged everything into the wrong place. Once your plug wire is loose, grab your new set and match it up as best as you can by length to the correct plug wire. Sometimes when you're lucky, they're both numbered. My new set is not. Reroute the spark plug wire from whence it came, and now I've got five more to do. It's like Legos for grown-ups. This goes here. Easy stuff. Number two's healthy at 53 thousandths. That actually surprises me a little after seeing the last one. Number three is 67 thousandths. It's used up just about as bad as number one. So two cylinders on the passenger side of the block are running hot. This is the side of the engine 60,000 miles ago where the lower intake manifold gasket failed. If the catalytic converter clogged, this makes sense. On the driver's side, you have to take a bunch of stuff loose in order to be able to get to the plugs and wires. The intake box is in the way, and I'm cool with that because I need to replace the filter anyway. There are mass airflow and intake temperature sensors that have to be unplugged, and once all that's gone and out of the way, it's easy enough to reach the plugs. Next plug. 55 thousandths. Pretty healthy. Looks normal for the end of its life. Not too bad, not too bad. New plug. Wire. I like to transfer over all the convoluted tubing to give the new wires a little more heat insulation and to protect them from abrasion. On some engines, every little bit you can do helps. Number 5 looks like it's right around 55 to 56 thousandths. Looks just like the last one. Pretty good, pretty good. New plug, wire, insulation. Moving on to number 6. Number 6 is right at the end, 56 thousandths. So one bank is hot, one bank is normal. The big question is whether replacing the plugs and wires alone will fix my misfire. If it was a fuel pressure problem, all 6 plugs would have been crispy. If that happened, I'd lean more towards the fuel filter, which is about to be replaced anyway. It's one of the required parts of the tune-up. And so is a new air filter now that we're putting this air box back together. I got my money's worth out of this thing too. Replace it every 30,000 miles. After everything's all buttoned back up, don't forget to plug all of your sensors back in and check all your vacuum hoses to make sure you didn't knock anything loose. On a Ford fuel filter, you need fuel line disconnect tools. I've had mixed luck with my set. The lines both look exactly the same to me, but I often need both the 5/16 and the 3/8 inch set to get mine to release. I just have that kind of luck, I guess. You pop the spring clips off the filter, you insert the tool to pop the lines loose, slide the old filter out, slide the new one in, reconnect your lines, install the clips, and then you're back in business. Because I depressurized the fuel system prior to installing the filter, I like to turn the key to key on, engine off a few times in order to repressurize the fuel system and to purge all the air out of the filter before using the starter. That should be enough. With the tune-up done, brakes and ball joints replaced, all I need now is 2 tires and an exhaust to pass inspection. Of course, it's getting an alignment when that happens as well. While I'm waiting for the exhaust to arrive, I'm off to take a test drive and see if the tune-up fixed my random misfire and how I did on the brake job. Anytime you do brake work, pump them up, then put it in gear, and then test them to make sure they're holding. Bad things can happen if you do that out of order. Let's go see what Chad's up to. Well, that's different, and yes, I'm jealous. Roof framed out, lift installed, massive one-car garage setup. Sure wish it was mine. Let's make good use of that lift. May I use it and put my truck up on it so that I can borrow your compression gauge, please? Thank you. Now show us the easy way to get to the plugs. It's pretty simple. Put the truck at eye level, pull the wheels and the wheel well liners out. With the plugs removed, screw in a compression gauge and go to town. Why am I doing this now? Well, because my random misfire became worse after the tune-up and just taking the short distance drive to get here. Let's go ahead and do the compression test anyway because I want the numbers. We hit 200, but it's falling. Something's leaking. It's falling. It's supposed to have a Schrader valve in the center of it.
It does, but maybe it's not. Sorry.
You're right.
Maybe it's not tight.
Hit 210. Still falling.
Okay, it still serves all intents and purposes.
Exactly. We're still getting the numbers, so. That's good. Mm-hmm. So this is number 6. Hit 210. That would have hit 210 if you cranked one more time. Alright, we're good. Good compression. And it's even. That was the only one that seemed like 2 pounds low. That number, yeah, number 3?
3?
Yes.
And 4.
1, 2, 3.
3 and 4 were 200, the rest are 210.
Not bad for 215,000 miles.
There's your numbers.
And there's your problem.
When I was installing clean plugs fresh out of the box, this wasn't so obvious, but after handling them with greasy hands, the problem became very apparent. 2 of the 6 plugs I installed had been dropped. I never dropped them, but what does it matter? Remember when I said you're the last step in quality control? I can only blame my own eyes for not seeing the cracked insulators. And it explains why it was running like poop. $4 fix. Oh hey, part of my exhaust system arrived. My F-150 has 4 catalytic converters and 4 O2 sensors. A primary on each manifold and a secondary on each half of the Y-pipe. These are the Walker OE replacement pipes, parts number 53338 and 54332. They are direct fit factory replacements for the Y-pipe with all provisions for O2 sensors, flanges, brackets, and catalytic converters. This is both the expensive and the right way to fix it, but it's less expensive than buying the same parts with a Ford sticker on them. We won't talk about the wrong way to fix this. I also bought new 2.5-inch exhaust donut gaskets and 4 2.5-inch pipe clamps that look like 2, but really I bought 4. Blame holiday shipping. Those came from my local auto parts store. My mission was to replace the now 17-year-old Y-pipe and muffler, which have never been removed from this truck. Even though these are considered bolt-ons, it's this stage of this repair that can be the most problematic. Chances are those nuts aren't going to just let go. I'm pretty sure they're going to put up a fight. Never mind that I'm doing a voiceover on a video that I already know the outcome of. Don't even pay attention to that. But pay attention to the 202 sensor harnesses under here with the blue plugs on them. Don't test the tensile strength of the wiring harness by forgetting to take them loose. These are about the only things you need to be careful with, but I'm going to take extra precautions not to snap off my exhaust manifold studs. Do everything in your power not to make this job harder for yourself than it has to be. So in my efforts to make my life easier, I like to have several cutting tools available for the sections that I know that I'll be replacing. And the basics like penetrating oil, fire, a hammer, sockets, and an air impact wrench. I'm laying on a mud flap here if you're wondering. I'll demonstrate a few other tools as they're needed. Let's start with fire. I like to get the nuts glowing hot because it burns off some of the oxides as well as it makes them swell up. Then I like to oil quench them so that it penetrates as deeply as possible into the threads. Oil is attracted to heat. Next, we'll try the socket with the air impact. No luck. Rounded off the nut. That sucker's not letting go. Oh well, let's try the other one. No luck there either. Stripped both exhaust nuts. Daggone it. I like it better when things are easy. That's why I bought a set of these. Twist sockets. These have a counterclockwise pattern internally that grabs onto rounded off bolts. There's a hex on the other side so that you can fit a socket over it. Don't waste your time on the 3/8 inch ratchet hole in the middle. Use a big socket. First, you hammer these things down on the nut or bolt that you're having trouble with. Then you grab a 22 millimeter socket and hit it with your impact wrench. Problem solved. It works a whole lot better than cutting exhaust studs because it saves you time. You don't have to replace studs. Probably the most important part of the process of using a twist socket is the time that you spend with a hammer, beating it down securely on the bolt or nut that you're working with. Once it bites, you end up with more leverage with a bigger socket, and the nut doesn't stand a chance. There goes the O2 sensor. Everything's loose on this side. Now repeat this on the other side. Most of the reason why the nuts on the driver's side stripped is because I couldn't get a straight shot at them with any of the tools that I had in my toolbox. There's a little better access on this side that allows me to operate without the swivel sockets or the universal joints. I just have to use a long extension. Using 6-point sockets with a straight shot on any nut or bolt greatly reduces your chances of stripping it. With both flanges loose and the O2 sensors unplugged, we can finally start removing these parts. Don't bother with trying to save the exhaust clamps. They're single use and they cost less than $2. If you have to remove them, just pull a Jesse Jackson and cut their nuts off. It takes all the fight right out of them. This is only something you do if you need to separate exhaust components in order to save one part or another. If you don't, because you're replacing the entire exhaust system like I am, just save yourself all the time and effort and get out your Sawzall. Relieve your destructive spirits in a constructive way. Do yourself a favor and cut the whole exhaust system out. Just look at your replacement hardware first to determine where you need to cut. You won't need to save any of this stuff. Separating the clamped joints can be a pain, and it's a lot more difficult to do up on jack stands than it would be on a lift. I've done it both ways, and there's just no comparison. Yay, my muffler finally came in. Before you climb back onto the concrete to install all of your exhaust parts, measure the flanges and take an inventory because you're probably going to need some stuff from your local auto parts store. I picked up 2 more exhaust clamps because the 4 I ordered still haven't arrived. I picked up a long section of 2.5-inch straight pipe for the piece that goes between the Y-pipe and the muffler, and I bought some new M10x1.5 flange nuts for both of the Y-pipe's exhaust flanges. And there you have it. For one brief moment, my old V6 truck had a dual exhaust. With that settled, now I have to move the O2 sensors over from the old exhaust to the new. This is also one of those things that's easier on a workbench. At least I think it is. That one was the driver's side. The passenger side put up a pretty good fight. I tried the torch, the penetrating oil, the O2 sensor wrench, a crescent wrench, fire and oil again, more crescent wrenching with the hammer, more fire, more oil, a crescent wrench, fire and oil again, more crescent wrenching with the hammer, more fire, more oil, cutting the harness off and using a socket, and using an angle grinder, a socket with an impact wrench, and finally throwing it across the room. That was the one I suspected of being clogged up with carbon. Strangely, I can't get it to let go of the O2 sensor, so I had to replace it. Brand new secondary O2 sensor. I didn't want to have to spend that $50, but the reality is that sometimes that sort of thing happens, and there's nothing you can do about it. Install both of the secondary O2 sensors, and then it's time to finally start putting this thing back together. Because of the 3 long pipes assembled with the catalytic converters on the passenger side, you have to lower this crossmember on the subframe for clearance. You just need a few inches for wiggle room so that you can route the front flange up into the manifold, and then you can reinstall the crossmember. Don't bolt or clamp anything in place yet, not until you have the whole Y-pipe assembled. The driver's side goes in last, and it's a piece of cake because it only has one little short bend in it. There's a nut that secures the Y-pipe section onto a rubber bushing on the crossmember. Get that situated and then honk down both of your flanges. If you have cast factory manifolds, you won't need those exhaust donut gaskets I showed earlier, but you will with an aftermarket manifold. I need to come up with a couple of exhaust hangers, and I'm really not feeling very creative at the moment. I figure I'll just cut the ones off of my old exhaust and weld them onto the new muffler, since the replacement muffler I bought came without them. Simple enough, clean them up with a grinder and a wire wheel, precision eyeball where to tack them down on the new muffler, weld them in place, and voila! Hanger problem solved! I'm still not permanently attaching clamps on any of these pipes yet. That comes last. Now that the muffler is hung in place, I need a section of pipe to join the Y pipe and the muffler. Measure, mark, and cut. Just be sure to measure from the end that has the right slip fit flange on it. Now that all these pieces are in place, it's time to install all the clamps with an impact wrench. There's two on the muffler and two on the Y pipe. 1, 2, 3, 4. Check your O2 sensor harness plugs, and you know what time it is. It's time to bring the noise! According to my AM/FM radio, it's just regular old 1147, but to me, it seemed a little bit more spectacular than that. Sorry about all that, guys. One last minor nuisance before I hit the road to get tires, alignment, and inspection is this dang headliner. It's a pretty easy fix, but nobody ever seems to do it. This is the spray adhesive to look for, and it's made for this. All the tools needed to take the headliner and trim apart are really simple. Flathead, Phillips head, pick. Carefully take your dome light cover off to get to the screws. If you have to pry, pry from somewhere that won't break it. Unscrew the dome light assembly, and once it's loose, unplug the electrical cable. Unscrew any of the other clothes hanger hooks or handles, and how far you have to remove the headliner depends on how badly this thing is separated. Mine's mostly on the driver's side, and if I peel it back, I have access to the whole thing without having to remove the whole headliner from the truck. Brush out any loose or dry rotted upholstery adhesive, and start by spraying both surfaces down into the furthest reaches of the damaged areas. It's best to stretch the fabric while you stick it down. Do it section by section. Reapply and work your way out. You should wait about 5 minutes after spraying a fresh section before sticking it back down, unless you're using a heat gun and a roller to set the glue. If you don't, it can pull itself back down again. Alternatively, you can sit in the vehicle and massage it for 20 or 30 minutes to make sure it sets. Once you're done, no more annoying headliner. There! After a quick tire, alignment, and state inspection, old Whitey's legal again. It got the love and attention it's deserved for several years. It really does deserve it, because this thing has faithfully carried me to and from work for 11 years and 110,000 miles without complaint. I at least owe it a hand wash. Normally it gets the drive-through machinery. It's a supremely low-maintenance vehicle despite the rumors. It's taken a bit here and there to maintain, mostly oil, tires, ball joints, and brake pads. Its first battery lasted 9 years. Oh yeah, I put a battery in it too. The second one didn't even make it to its second birthday, because this truck sat for a few months and it developed a dead cell. But anyway, why should any of you care about the $3,000 laundry list of problems being fixed on a 17-year-old truck? It's because I had a great experience with it and it permanently changed my driveway. If you own a wrench on 90s turbo DSM stuff for kicks, you will keep neither a girlfriend nor a job with just one DSM in your driveway. You're gonna need something else reliable to drive. This truck filled that void while giving me the capacity to haul my belongings, car parts, and yard waste around. I like to leave things better than I found them, but this one decided to show its age at a busy, inconvenient time in my life when I needed to feel and experience some of the rewards of my hard work. It became another running vehicle with a non-current inspection in my driveway, and if you've read any of my comments and other videos, you know why that's a problem for me. I couldn't afford to fix all of its problems at once. I needed transportation to my day job, and the first car payment I've had in 12 years suddenly became a cheaper option to fix all of my problems at once. Please allow me to introduce to you old Whitey's distant and much hotter cousin, Big Red. Those of you who recognize me at the shootout got to see it already. The shootout was a last-minute arrangement for me with next to zero planning, and it wouldn't have been possible without Tom's generous offer for a place to stay. Thank you, Tom! It also wouldn't have been possible unless I bought a vehicle that could have made the journey there and back. I couldn't find a trailer in the time that remained between buying the truck and the shootout so I could tow any of my cars to the event, but I was better off doing this as a spectator because there was just too much to see and to do in the short time that I was there. I had a blast meeting all of you, watching so many awesome vehicles race, and spending time with vendors, fans, YouTubers, and legends of the DSM community alike. It may have been my first shootout, but thanks to all involved with helping me experience it, I know it won't be my last. I bought Big Red on the 4th of July, 2015 with super low miles, and it was previously owned by a 5 foot 2 inch, 100 pound fitness instructor, a non-smoker who wasn't even heavy enough to leave a butt print in the seat. She traded it in on an F-250 Super Duty diesel. This was her baby, and it was flawless. She had great taste. The 402A option package is the same one found in the California Special Mustang with the 5-liter Coyote V8. Except that my truck sits 3 feet higher and has a 6-speed 4-wheel drive automatic transmission, complete with electronic locking 373 rear differential. It has a trailer brake with bias control, trailer stability and traction control, and the FX4 off-road suspension package. I'd feel a lot less guilty about hooking a trailer to this thing than I would that Mustang, but the body graphics package, projector headlights, blacked out wheels, and painted trim, along with the Microsoft Sync technology package, which includes voice-controlled navigation, MP3 audio-video entertainment system, Bluetooth and internet connectivity, integrated backup camera, and the air-conditioned heated driver's seat and passenger seat would offer the Mustang owner a very similar experience driving down the street. It's just 3 feet higher, 2,000 pounds more.
This is mine. Yes, this is mine. I can't believe this is mine.
Everything that can be powered is, plus I've got room for 5 grown-ass men.
So I got 5 grown-ass men up in here.
And that Mustang just doesn't have it like I've got it. Don't count on a series of videos immediately bolting a Kenny Bell, Eaton, or Whipple supercharger on it. Not yet. It still has 90,000 miles left on warranty, and for now I'm just enjoying it. It handles like a dream. A really big dream. A very large, quiet, comfortable, voice-activated, surround-sounded, luxurious dream. I hope it's every bit as nice to me as old Whitey's been. Old Whitey's just glad it doesn't have to pull a trailer. But old Whitey's really happy to be getting this much of my attention and still playing in the snow with me. I leave Big Red at home on days like this. No sense in covering it in sand and road salt or collecting dents from other drivers with all-wheel drive that haven't figured out all-wheel stop yet. I did the block and coolant system tests to verify the investment was worthwhile. And it was. The things it needed were not cheap, and I didn't cut corners fixing any of them. It's the first time in 11 years that this truck has cost me much of anything to keep running. And now I've still got a viable beater truck to keep the miles off of Big Red, and a truck with which I don't mind hauling dirty and stinky things. Maybe if I decide that it's excessive to have 2 full-size trucks in the driveway, I'll wait for hunting season and let one of them go, but on a day like this, it's really nice to have old Whitey back. Thanks for tuning in to watch me save this thing from the scrap heap, and until next time, stay tubed.
You got a rope? You got a rope?
I thought I'd give them a little help. See if they make it through at that time. All right. They're gonna make it home. Good times.